Good morning, welcome to St. Nicholas Barthampton for our live stream service. Sorry, we're starting a minute late. We've had some technical issues after I got back late from the real service at St. Mary's Claverton. But hope you're able to see us now, and I'll give some notices at the end, the notices that would have been on a loop before you won't have seen if you arrived a bit early for the service. We're going to hear Jesus' message about forgiveness today, and it's a really important thing for us to focus on. We were thinking a bit about dealing with sin and getting rid of it. The important thing for us to remember now is that we have the same God who's been God all the way through the Old Testament, whose son, the Lord Jesus, came to express this. And a number of times in the Old Testament, you get this statement, and we looked at it from a different place in the Old Testament last week. Here it is on the lips of the prophet Jonah, who said it in quite a stroppy way, really, because Jonah wasn't happy about this. He was annoyed by God when he said, "I knew that you are a gracious and compassionate God, slow to anger, and abounding in love, a God who relents from sending calamity." That's our God. And we should be so grateful that he is like that. He's gracious and compassionate. Everyone needs compassion. And in this song that we can now sing together, if you'd like to join in out loud in your home, or just listen to, we celebrate that God is mighty to save, and we pray, "Let mercy fall on me." We need God's mercy and forgiveness.
Thank you.
One of the things I love doing as rector of Bathampton is going into Bathampton Primary School, and sometimes I join in the playground after taking an assembly. And we haven't been able to have assemblies for quite a long time for obvious reasons, but what they are doing now in the school is doing it online, I think in the classrooms on video. And I was invited to do an to record an assembly and send it in. I wonder how many people from Bathampton Primary School are watching this. I'm guessing maybe Grace might be seeing this now, and Noah and Arthur and Rory. And I wonder if there's anybody else. Could you text in perhaps and let me know whether you've seen this already in school, or if you see it next week, let me know if you've seen it. And well, I'm going to show the church now the message that I sent in to the school, and then that can help us to know a bit more about what's going on between the church and the school, which is not a church school, and we can pray more for the school. So here's what I said last Tuesday to them. Well, thank you very much, Mr. Brewer, for inviting me to do an assembly. Good morning, boys and girls. Lovely to be with you this morning at Bathampton Primary School. I would have been, Mr. Brewer had invited me to come into his office to do this assembly. But last night, one of my sons had a high temperature. And so we've been told that we need to isolate for 2 weeks or until we can get a negative test. And there aren't any tests available at the moment. So we might be stuck at home for quite a long time. But it's great that I can talk to you like this. Now, out on our drive, there's this funny purple stuff on the ground. I don't know if it's because the birds have been eating berries, but there's all this disgusting, yucky stuff. And I've got some on my hand, and it's really horrible. Oh well, at least I've got one clean hand. Oh no, I put it on my other hand. Oh, now I've got two yucky and I've got it on my face. Oh, and I'm supposed to be doing an assembly for you. I'm really sorry, excuse me a minute, I'll just go and get cleaned up. Oh, well, I think that's got most of it off anyway. So where was I? Oh, I was going to tell you a bit about something about Jesus, but you know when you've got yucky stuff or dirt on your hands or anywhere and you touch something else, it goes from one thing to another. And it's a bit like that with the virus, isn't it? The germs. And we've all got to keep a distance away from each other and be careful not to pass on the germs from one to another. And it can be very difficult for, especially for older people who might be living on their own, if they're not allowed to be close to other people, it can get lonely. And we might be frightened of helping somebody in case we catch something from them or give them something. I want to tell you something about Jesus. When he met a man who had a horrible disease called leprosy, and that would affect people's skin, and there was no cure for it, no treatment. So in Jesus' time, if you got leprosy, you knew that that meant it was going to kill you. And you knew that that meant you had to keep away from everybody else, and really severe social distancing with no phones and no Zoom or FaceTime to keep in touch with people. It would be horrible to have leprosy. And this man came up to Jesus and he said, "Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean." He fell down on the ground before Jesus to say this. He was begging Jesus because he was desperate for help. And he called Jesus, "Lord, Master, if you're willing, you can make me clean." Now, most people, if they saw somebody with leprosy coming up fairly close to them, would say, get back, get away, and would go away from the person. But Jesus did an extraordinary thing. He reached out his hand and touched the man. He touched him. So everyone would expect, now Jesus has got that yucky leprosy on his hand. But the Bible teaches us, and Christians believe, that Jesus is different from everybody else. Instead of the disease making him dirty, he could make the diseased person clean. And Christians believe that only Jesus can do that. And according to the Bible, this is what happened. Immediately, the leprosy left the man. And so he was well again. And can you imagine how happy he would be, having had this horrible disease, then to be well? And once the doctors had said, yes, you're fine, you haven't got leprosy anymore, he'd be able to be in touch with his family again and go and see his friends and go out with them and play sport and all those things that he wouldn't have been able to do before, and work as well. And what can we learn from that? Well, Christians believe that we all need to come to Jesus to be cleaned on the inside. And another thing that we can all take from this is the thought, how can we help somebody even without getting the risk of infection and that kind of thing? We're not Jesus, and we can't break the social distancing rules or break whatever rules there are to keep us safe. We need to follow those rules, but there are still ways that we can help somebody and help them not to feel lonely. And we might see somebody's need. Maybe we've got grandparents who live nearby or live a long way away, and we can phone them up or do a video call with them and cheer them up. Maybe it's not just grandparents, but there's somebody living near to us who lives on their own that we could cheer up in some way as well. And within school, if somebody's sad, there are ways that we can try and help them and be kind to them whilst keeping safe, but without letting the fear of infection stop us from doing kind things. Now, I would like to say a prayer. And so if you would like to talk to Jesus with me, you might like to shut your eyes or just be quiet and listen for a moment. And you can say these words in your heart to Jesus as well. If you're not someone who prays and you don't want to join in the prayer, it's fine just to listen quietly and respectfully for others. Lord Jesus, thank you that you love sad and lonely and diseased and dirty, mucky people. People like us, who've all got dirtiness on the inside. Thank you for your love, and please help us to love other people. Please help those people who are ill at the moment, those who are in hospital, and those who are on their own and might be feeling lonely. Please help those who are caring for them, the doctors and nurses, and all the other workers who are looking after people in need, and help each one of us to be kind. Thank you again for your kindness to us. And please may your blessing be on Barthampton Primary School and all the hard-working teachers and other staff and boys and girls and their families. Amen. Well, I look forward to seeing you again sometime soon. Hope you all have a good day today and stay safe. So, assembly for Bathampton Primary School that I'd recorded. And the update since recording that is that Harry's COVID test came back negative. So we were, in a sense, declared clean and could meet people in normal socially distanced way again, where we were isolated for a couple of days. Those who've been at junior church, I hope you've had a good time. I look forward to hearing how that went from 10 till 10:40. I know at least one of the groups had some technical difficulty towards the end. Hope it's gone well. We're really thankful to God and for those who've been helping lead junior church in these little groups on Zoom. And if there are any children watching or anyone who's got children that you might like to give this a try, please do get in touch and we'll be able to link you up with a Zoom group. If boys and girls want to be doing something else for the rest of the service, to leave the grown-ups to focus on the other things that we're going to hear and read and pray and think about, then that's fine by me. One of the first things we're going to do now is hear from Margaret Askew, a member of St Nicholas's who lives on her own in Harberts, and Emily went to talk to her and recorded this conversation for us. So thank you, Emily, for doing that. And let's hear now from Margaret.
Hello, Margaret.
Hello, Emily. Welcome to Harberts.
Thank you. Thank you so much for asking me over, and we can just have a little chat about how you've been finding things over the last, well, really the last 6-7 months of the pandemic.
Yes. As you see, Harberts is a lovely community, and we've been looking out for each other. And we have the oversight of our lovely manager, Jane, which is nice to know. Obviously, in the passage of such a long space of time, some people have become frail and are confined to quarters. But that's just the way life would be without the virus element.
Yes.
I've been keeping busy and found all sorts of ways to use my time. The week has been strange, I think, for a lot of people because it's lost its sort of shape without regular going to church and many other things we did before.
That's so true.
But I found time for Bible study and more reading, which I've really enjoyed.
Yes.
I've made 150 face masks.
That's wonderful.
And I've recently borrowed a piano keyboard from a granddaughter, so I'm learning to play again. Haven't done that for 30 or 40 years.
That's marvellous. Such a good idea. Really good. And could you tell me, Margaret, because I think it's always really encouraging for the church family to hear, could you please tell me how you came about to be a Christian?
I will. I was very fortunate in growing up in a really Christian household. Regular church worship, sometimes 2 or 3 times on a Sunday. Lots of hymn singing around the piano. Sunday school, then later Sunday school teacher, bell ringer, member of the youth club, so on and so on. And I love looking around at St Nick's when we're there and seeing the young families. It's just such a beautiful sight these days to see that the whole families coming to church. And I would encourage anybody who's finding it tricky to get all your family mustered and in church just to keep on, keep trying, because the example of my parents has been a backbone in my own life. So plant the seed, water the sapling, and look after the roots. And my own story goes on that I was lucky enough to go with many others of my generation to hear Billy Graham, one of his crusades, and at that moment I knew that I had found where my faith should be, and my little roots tapped in and became independent and has stayed with me ever since.
Yes.
I was then fortunate enough to get a job in Oxford working for a big church, St Aldate's Church, and that's where I met Richard. He later, of course, became ordained, and I became a clergy wife. And
yes.
God has been very good.
Yes. I loved the phrase you just used about seeds growing roots and then watering the saplings. And you told me earlier a wonderful story about an acorn that has been planted.
Yes.
Why didn't you say, why is that so special?
Yes, that was to commemorate the birth of my fourth great-grandchild.
Congratulations.
Percy, who was born 3 weeks ago.
Yes.
And his dad asked me to pick some acorns from just over Richard's gravestone.
That's,
and plant them, and I've done that. They're all in my little greenhouse.
That's,
hopefully they will germinate.
So special. A lovely,
yes.
Lovely story. Now, is there a particular hymn, Margaret, that's very special to you?
Yes, I have. I love all hymns, so it's been quite difficult to choose. But I've chosen one which can be released from its music, beautiful though the music is, and used as a prayer. And this is a prayer to that God would grant some of the attributes of Jesus' character to us. It's, may the mind of Christ my Saviour live in me from day to day, by his love and power controlling all I do or say. May the word of God dwell richly in my heart from hour to hour, so that I may triumph only through his saving power. May the peace of God my Father rule my life in everything, that I may be calm to comfort sick and sorrowing. May the love of Jesus fill me as the waters fill the sea. Him exalting, self-abasing, this is victory. May I run the race before me, strong and brave to face the foe, looking only unto Jesus as I onward go.
Amen to that. That's beautiful. Thank you very much for sharing with us.
Thank you, Emily.
Thank
you. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you, Margaret and Emily. Lovely to see the sunshine in Harberts from just a few days ago. Amazing how much the weather's changed already. And that lovely hymn about the mind of Christ makes me think, yes, that's a prayer I want to pray. I want God to help me to think more like Jesus and to be more like him. And I know that I've so often failed in so many ways to do the things that I ought to do and to show the love of Jesus in the kind of way that he did. And people who trust Jesus have always had this experience, we know that. Even the ones who lived before Jesus' time, who were trusting God's mercy and God's promise of a future rescuer, like David, the king of Israel, who messed up big time, and the psalm that he wrote, Psalm 51, was one of his many songs that he wrote. This one says, it's for the director of music, a psalm of David, when the prophet Nathan came to him after David had committed adultery with Bathsheba. So David had done something really bad, and he cried out to God for forgiveness. The prophet Nathan had told him a story, and it was about somebody being unkind to a poor person and stealing their sheep. And David, when he heard this story, was very angry with the unkind person, said, that person deserves to die. And Nathan said to him, you are the man. And God's message to David was that he had gone wrong, and he needed this forgiveness. I heard Ian's sermon this morning at St Mary's. It's what we're going to hear in a few minutes' time here on the St Nicholas live stream. And there were echoes of that incident with Nathan telling the parable and the conviction that was brought to David. If we're experiencing conviction and recognising that we've done wrong, we need to ask for God's mercy. So let's use David's words, and I'm going to read out this prayer, this song, this psalm, Psalm 51, the first 12 verses of it. And you might like to join in out loud, or you might like just to listen. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love, according to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions. Wash away all my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is always before me. Against you, you only, have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight. So you're right in your verdict and justified when you judge. Surely I was sinful at birth, sinful from the time my mother conceived me. Yet you desire faithfulness. Even in the womb, you taught me wisdom in that secret place. Cleanse me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones you have crushed rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquity. Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me. It's great to know that God keeps his promises to forgive all who come to him. It's the nature of God that he loves to forgive. He sent his son Jesus to die and rise again to reconcile us to him. Thank you, Lord, for that. Let's turn to the Bible now, and Hannah is reading our Old Testament reading first. Nehemiah, some people say he was the smallest person in the Bible, but others say that was Bildad the Shuhite. Anyway, his book is quite hard to find, and we don't turn to it all that often, but it's kind of after the, it's towards the end of Old Testament history, so it's after the books like Kings and Chronicles, and before you get to the Psalms, so if you're wanting to find it in your own Bible, there you go. The words will be up on the screen anyway, so don't worry if you can't find it. But it would be worth having your own Bible for the New Testament reading, because even though that would be up on the screen as well, Ian's going to be referring back to it in the sermon. This reading from Nehemiah, Hannah will very helpfully help us briefly get it in its context, but it includes the great statement about God, that same kind of thing that we've heard earlier this morning, that Nehemiah says to God, "You are a forgiving God, gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, and abiding in love."
Today's Old Testament reading is from Nehemiah chapter 9, verses 16 to 21. In this section of the passage, the Levites have gathered all the Israelites, and they are remembering how God brought the Israelites out of Egypt and provided for them in the desert. Verse 16. But they, our forefathers, became arrogant and stiff-necked and did not obey your commands. They refused to listen and failed to remember the miracles you performed among them. They became stiff-necked and in their rebellion appointed a leader in order to return to their slavery. But you are a forgiving God, gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and abounding in love. Therefore, you did not desert them. Even when they cast for themselves an image of a calf and said, "This is your God who brought you up out of Egypt," or when they committed awful blasphemies. Because of your great compassion, you did not abandon them in the desert. By day, the pillar of cloud did not cease to guide them on their path, nor the pillar of fire by night to shine on the way they were to take. You gave your good spirit to instruct them. You did not withhold your manna from their mouths, and you gave them water for their thirst. For 40 years you sustained them in the desert. They lacked nothing. Their clothes did not wear out, nor did their feet become swollen.
God is merciful. What love could remember no wrongs we have done? Omniscient, all-knowing, he counts not their sum. Thrown into a sea without bottom or shore, our sins, they are many. His mercy is more.
Praise the Lord. His mercy is more, stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many. His mercy is more. Omniscient, all-knowing, he counts not their sum. Thrown into a sea without bottom or shore, our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Mercy is more.
our sins they are many, his mercy is more. If we've experienced God's mercy, what difference should that make to our relationships with other people? What about when they do wrong things to us? Let's hear what Jesus said about that.
The New Testament reading is taken from Matthew chapter 18, verses 21 to 35, the parable of the unmerciful servant. Then Peter came to Jesus and asked, "Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother when he sins against me? Up to seven times?" Jesus answered, "I tell you, not seven times, but 77 times. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. As he began the settlement, a man who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. Since he was not able to pay, the master ordered that he and his wife and his children and all that he had be sold to repay the debt. The servant fell on his knees before him. 'Be patient with me,' he begged, 'and I will pay back everything.' The servant's master took pity on him, cancelled the debt and let him go. But when that servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii. He grabbed him and began to choke him. 'Pay back what you owe me,' he demanded. His fellow servant fell to his knees and begged him, 'Be patient with me and I will pay you back.' But he refused. Instead, he went off and had the man thrown into prison until he could pay the debt. When the other servants saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed and went and told their master everything that had happened. Then the master called the servant in. 'You wicked servant,' he said, 'I cancelled all that debt of yours because you begged me to. Shouldn't you have had mercy on your fellow servant, just as I had on you?' In his anger, his master turned him over to the jailers to be tortured until he should pay back all he owed. This is how my heavenly Father will treat each of you unless you forgive your brother from your heart."
Thank you. Good morning. Let's pray. Lord, give us ears to hear and hearts ready to put your word into practice. Amen. Jesus often spoke in parables, vivid stories full of pictures that would have resonated with those who heard him, but whose spiritual meaning was often not immediately obvious. "Whoever has ears, let them hear," Jesus said when he told the parable of the sower in Matthew 13. But afterwards he explained its meaning to his disciples when they asked him why he spoke in this way. The problem with the parable of the unmerciful servant in Matthew 18 is that its message is crystal clear. The king shows undeserved mercy to his servant by cancelling the enormous debt he owed him. But the servant fails to show any mercy to his fellow servant, who owed him a trifling amount by comparison. Upon learning of the servant's wickedness, the king then reverses his earlier action and hands the man over to the jailers to deal with him until he repays all the debt. It's tempting to try to work out the sums of money that might have been involved. One bag of gold, or one talent, was worth about 20 years of a day labourer's wages. So 10,000 bags would have been equivalent to what one person might have earned in 200,000 years. So much for the servant's plea, verse 26. "Be patient with me and I will pay back everything." This was an utterly unrealistic proposition. What a cheeky rascal, we might say. But the servant's master took pity on him, cancelled the debt and let him go. The king's original order was for the servant, together with his wife and family, to be sold to repay the debt. In view of the astronomical amount of the debt, their selling price would have been a mere drop in the ocean. By comparison, the debt owed by the fellow servant was equivalent to about 100 days of a day labourer's wage. However, if we get caught up in doing mental arithmetic with these amounts, we've completely missed the point. Don't even think for one moment that the debt owed to the king could ever have been paid by that servant. The story so far would have shocked, engaged, and surprised Jesus' listeners and made them smile. But Jesus has not finished yet. His final word to the disciples, verse 35, is, "This is how my heavenly Father will treat each of you, unless you forgive your brother or sister from your heart." We'll come back to this a little later, but for now just note that this is the point when those listening to Jesus realise, to their horror, that they are the man in the story, the unmerciful servant. The parable was, of course, Jesus' response to Peter's question, verse 21. "Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother or sister who sins against me? Up to seven times?" Apparently the rabbis of the day taught that it should be three times, so perhaps Peter thought that he was being very generous and was proposing exceptional patience by suggesting seven times. Jesus' immediate reply, verse 22, not seven times, but 77 times, or it could be 70 times seven, however, suggests a radically different perspective to Peter and to us. If we're still counting how many times we've forgiven someone, we're not really forgiving them at all, but simply postponing revenge. Don't even think about counting, just do it. How did Jesus teach us to pray? "Our Father, forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors." Matthew 6, verse 12, quickly followed in verses 14 and 15 by these words, "For if you forgive other people when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their sins, your Father will not forgive your sins." Neither here nor in the parable does it mean that God's forgiving of us is, in the first place, dependent on our being merciful. No, the original debt is forgiven quite freely. But accepting God's forgiveness means being accepted into the community of forgiven sinners, the family of God called to reflect his nature. There is no such thing as private forgiveness by God. We are forgiven personally and individually, but accepting forgiveness requires the willingness to stand with all others who acknowledge their sin and helplessness. Not to forgive indicates that we have not really grasped how much God has forgiven us, that we have not really accepted his forgiveness and joined the community of the forgiven. What is the debt we owe God? If we consider this simply as the sum total of an accountant's ledger recording all our sins one by one, we make the same mistake as when we count how many times we forgive someone else. We have missed the point. Even though it's true that, as it were, our account has been wiped clean, our debt to God is beyond counting. Being made in his image, he calls us, each one of us, to reflect his image in every aspect of our lives, in service and in worship. By not doing so, we turn away from God and, tempted to sin, we fall into the influence of unseen forces that control us, whether we are aware of it or not. By means of his death and resurrection, Jesus Christ, the Messiah, has not only cancelled and forgiven the sum total of my sins and of your sins, but has defeated the power of those unseen forces. He's won the victory over sin, with a capital S, and death, with a capital D, removing both their penalty and their power. However, if we, having been shown incalculable mercy, fail then to behave mercifully towards others, we remain in denial of our need for forgiveness and remain in the grip of sin and death. Maybe that is what is alluded to in the parable when the unmerciful servant is handed over to the jailers. Forgiveness is like the air in our lungs. There's only room for us to inhale the next lungful once we've breathed out the last one. If we insist on withholding it, refusing to give to someone the kiss of life they may desperately need, we won't be able to take in any more for ourselves, and we'll suffocate very quickly. Whatever the spiritual, moral, and emotional equivalent of the lungs is, it's either open or closed. If it's open, able and willing to forgive others, it will also be open to receive God's love and forgiveness. But if it's locked up to the one, it will be locked up to the other. This is a hard lesson to learn in our thinking and also in our behaviour. Like everything else in Matthew 18, it goes back to the picture of the child. What is it that stops us either saying sorry or saying, I forgive you? Isn't it just that unchildness, that I'm too important to do that-ness, which shows that we've forgotten, or perhaps never learned, that the greatest in the kingdom of heaven is the one who's been turned inside out and has become like a little child? This book, Why Forgive, is full of true life stories of people who have discovered for themselves the necessity of forgiveness. One man said this: there is a very pragmatic reason for forgiving. When we are wronged, we can either respond by seeking revenge or we can forgive. If we choose revenge, our lives will be consumed by anger. When vengeance is served, it leaves one empty. Anger is a hard urge to satisfy and can become habitual. But forgiveness allows us to move on. There is also a more compelling reason to forgive. Forgiveness is a gift. It is mercy. It is a gift that I have received and also given away. In both cases, it has been completely satisfying. Another passage says this: we all know bitter people. They have an amazing memory for the tiniest detail, and they wallow in self-pity and resentment. They catalogue every offence and are always ready to show others how much they have been hurt. On the outside, they may appear to be calm and composed, but inside they are about to burst with pent-up feelings. Bitter people defend their grudges constantly. They feel they've been hurt too deeply and too often, and that this exempts them from the need to forgive. But it is just these people who need to forgive most of all. Their hearts are sometimes so full of rancour that they no longer have the capacity to love. Do you know anyone who fits this description? If so, they need our prayers. Bitterness is more than a negative outlook on life. It is a power, and a destructive and self-destructive one at that. Like a cancerous cell, a dangerous mould or a spore, it thrives in the dark recesses of the heart and feeds on every new thought of spite or hatred that comes along. And like an ulcer aggravated by worry or a heart condition made worse by stress, it can be physically as well as emotionally debilitating. Many of the stories in the book concern people who have suffered severely at the hands of another person, often very dramatically. No wonder they may have been tempted to become bitter and unforgiving until they came to realise how necessary for their own well-being it was to forgive the offender. Most of us, thank God, will not be the victim of a major life-changing incident, but unless we're totally isolated from all other people, every one of us will be affected by the wrongdoings of other people in the little things that happen in everyday life, time and time again. All of us are faced daily with the need to forgive a partner, a child, a friend or a colleague, perhaps dozens of times in a single day. And the need to forgive is just as important. Perhaps the hardest thing about practicing forgiveness in daily life is that it requires us to confront the reality of our feelings towards those we know best. It's difficult enough to forgive a stranger we might never see again, but it's much harder to forgive a person we love and trust. We have to recognise that we are not blameless ourselves. We need God's forgiveness for all the little niggles, minor grudges and ongoing resentments that we hold against other people we know well. We must acknowledge our own weakness and experience forgiveness for ourselves in order to forgive others as we should do. And if our forgiveness is to bear fruit, the soil around it, the soil of the heart, must be soft enough for it to grow in. If it's not soft, if we're not willing to be humble and vulnerable, our forgiveness will never be more than a fruitless gesture. Forgiveness isn't an occasional act, it's a permanent attitude. It's something we have to work for, just as we have to work to keep our body fit and our mind alert. So we must work on our heart too. Forgiving isn't just a one-time decision. We have to live forgiveness every day. The final words of the parable drive the lesson home to us with penetrating simplicity. There's the pivotal unless in verse 35, unless you forgive your brother or your sister. A door that both invites and warns. And there's the final thrust of from your heart. All the talk of sevens and 10,000s is not there to leave us doing mental arithmetic, but to shame us and to kindle us so that we are moved, like the king in the parable, to be merciful. One last quote from the book I mentioned. Once you're able to let go of wrongs that have been done to you, it changes everything. It changes your relationships, your attitudes, your emotional makeup, your whole approach to living. It will give you a better life. Plus, you'll find that when you forgive, you're always a winner. You don't lose a thing. This may sound illogical or impossible to some. Others will find it downright ridiculous. But I'm talking as one who's lived through this. Forgiving is the most beautiful expression of love. It's not a sign of weakness, it's a sign of strength. Let's pray. Lord, you are a forgiving God, gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and abounding in love. Help us to reflect your nature in our lives each day. You know that we often find it so difficult to forgive. At those times, remind us again of how much you have forgiven us and fill us again with your love. Amen.
Well, let's pray to our loving, forgiving Father. We continue in prayer as Angela leads us.
We come to you in prayer this morning, Heavenly Father, thanking you for your faithfulness to us in our lives. And humbly, we thank you for your continual mercy that we hardly deserve ourselves and need to show more of it to others. For we know you are a forgiving God, slow to anger and abounding in love. So we ask your forgiveness today for all our mistakes that we remember and regret, and for those wrongdoings that we do not recognise when we commit them in our selfishness. We are sorry for the judgments that we make against each other and those we fail to make against ourselves. Help us to care for those in greater need with kinder words and gentle actions. Father, we thank you for our church and village. We thank you for Jonty and all those who help him to give us our church service online each week. We pray for anyone who is unwell, lonely or bereaved at this time, asking that they will know the comfort of your love. Please, God, help also those who are struggling with their lives, unable to find work or to be with their families. We pray that in this winter of uncertainty and doubt, we do not walk into the fear of not trusting you. We ask for guidance for the government that they can make the right decisions for the months ahead. The councils too, that they give the best support to those who need it. And we pray for compassion and energy for carers in all communities as they look after the ill and elderly. We bring to you, Father, the young people at universities and schools who are trying to lead a normal life, combining education and being with their friends, and also their teachers and those in charge. Please guide them all in dealing with the problems of the virus and the restrictions it is bringing to their lives. Lord, as you did to the Israelites, give us your light to show us the way we ought to take. We can call on you, knowing that you will answer us. You will always be with us in trouble. And through Jesus, you are with us always. Amen.
Amen. And we're going to pray the Lord's Prayer together now. If you're joining in out loud, just a heads up that I'm going to have a pause after the line about forgiving those who sin against us, so that we can think and pray a bit more about that and consciously let go of any grudges that we might be holding and forgive those who sin against us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Well, thank you everyone who's been involved in this service. Thank you, Ian, for the really helpful sermon, and Angela for those prayers. Been saying do text in. There's my mobile number, you can send me a text. I've had a few texts, I haven't read them yet, so let's have a look at what they say. And questions about the sermon, if anyone's got one of those, we'll see what happens as to whether Ian can text in an answer if someone's fired in a question, or it leads to more discussion on Zoom coffee later. But here's one from Carl Fullaway. I just saw it says, is a spork out of the question, but that was a previous text from a previous live stream. He says, Grace hasn't seen it yet. That's the school assembly, but finding it quite funny. David Peel, all now working. Oh, that's because of his previous text. It might be human error, but I can't make the church YouTube link work for today. That was something to do with a software update on the streaming software just before the service. I got one from Harry asking me if I've left Claverton yet, because I was late back from St Mary's. Maybe I should be looking at these, but I didn't want to miss any of the sermon and be looking in advance. And O'Reilly's given his apologies because he would have been at St Mary's. Ray and Sheila, like our family, had flu jabs yesterday morning. Let's pray for Ray as he's taking a funeral of a friend tomorrow at 1 o'clock. So pray for recovery for him as he's not feeling well. Here's one from a lady called Carol, who says, thanks Ian for a great sermon, and what's the name of the book, please? And that reminds me of another message that has come in on WhatsApp, because I asked Ian to give us again the details of that book that he held up about forgiveness. And it is available on Amazon. It's called Why Forgive, and it's by Johann Christoph Arnold. Let's see if we can get that without too much reflection on the screen. There we are. Johann Christoph Arnold, Why Forgive. I don't know whether it's in print or not, but Ian has confirmed it is available on Amazon. It sounds like a really helpful book I hadn't come across before. The annual church meeting is next Sunday afternoon. On Zoom, we can't get everybody into the same room for the meeting, so we're having it virtually. Do come along to that. The meeting details are on the email I sent out a couple of weeks ago. I'll send it again during the week to our mailing list. So make sure you're on the mailing list. If you're not, then there are instructions on the church website for signing up through MailChimp to the email list. And for that, let me just say about the annual meeting, we'll be having elections in a separate meeting immediately before it for church wardens. So pray for Anna and Paul. Ian is retiring as church warden, and we thank Ian for his service. We're also having elections for Deanery Synod and the PCC, our Parochial Church Council. Those who are standing, I haven't had many of your nomination forms in yet, so please do see if you can get those signed and ideally emailed into me, or in on a bit of paper is fine as well, is great. That needs to be done this week. And the plan approved by the PCC a week or two ago is that this live stream service, which I've been doing here in front of my map of Bathampton, and thanks Dennis Clark for that, and Anne Wills for the artwork, and my radiator. You might be getting a bit fed up with that view, and we're going to be doing the live stream from in church, which I'm really excited about. Actually, I think it's is a great step forward, because we'll be able to involve more people live, and not just sending in recordings, but hopefully have the reader there and have some interviews. Music is going to be a challenging thing. We'll probably have less singing because we're not allowed to sing congregationally, but still very much something to watch from home at 10:45. And then in time, God willing, we'll gradually open up and invite in a congregation to be present, as well as continuing the live stream. So we're moving on to a kind of hybrid, and let's be praying for God's blessing on that. There's a new camera being installed in church and that kind of thing, to be ready for that. Virtual coffee today, on the same Zoom meeting, at Zoom number as usual, 861-2531-2351, Nigel Shepherd is going to lead one of his famous quizzes. So don't miss virtual coffee. If you haven't been for a few weeks, come along today. It's going to be great fun. Always is when Nigel leads a quiz. It'd be great to have a good number there to see each other. It won't go on for ages, but come join in the quiz, encourage each other, and have a good lunch. And here is our next hymn. Here is love vast as the ocean. God's loving kindness, his mercy, comes like a flood. He is so generous. And so our challenge is to be merciful like him, and to share that grace and forgiveness. So let's look back to what God has done in his great loving kindness, and look forward as well, asking his help for our lives to reflect that grace.
Thank you.
So see you at Zoom coffee. Let's pray. May the love of the Lord Jesus draw you to himself. May the joy of the Lord Jesus fill your hearts. May the power of the Lord Jesus strengthen you in his service. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon us and remain with us always. Amen.